الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. وpraises due to Allah. عليكم السلام ورحمة الله. And we ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to send His peace and His blessings and to exalt the mention of the Prophet Muhammad, his companions, and all those who follow them on their righteous path until the day of judgment. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us the opportunity to be gathered again in the third class of the book Sharh Usul al-Iman, the explanation of the fundamentals of faith. And if you remember, maybe when the brothers are through with their salah, I will question some of the attendees about what happened last week. In the meantime, we continue with the statement of Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, who said, فَبِالْإِخْلَاصِ تَتَحَقَّقُ شَهَادَةَ اللَّا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَبِالْمُتَابَعَةَ لِلرَّسُولِ صلى الله عليه وسلم تَتَحَقَّقُ شَهَادَةَ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولَهُ. He said, sincerity is established and attained through the testimony that there is no God worthy of worship except Allah. And the following of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam manifests and is required through the statement وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. So the summary of our religion is really two things: believing in the oneness of Allah and believing and following the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the believer will increase in his iman and decrease according to how much of these he has in his life. The more we are sincere to Allah in our acts of worship, and the more we follow the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the better Muslims we will be, the higher our iman, the chances of entering paradise will become much more abundant, as opposed to someone who does not take these matters seriously enough. You know, as many of the Muslims nowadays, may Allah rectify our condition, who believe in the Shahada, otherwise they will not be Muslims. But the implication of this statement is almost absent. You can hardly see any traces of it. So much so that you will not know this person is a Muslim unless you sit down and have a long conversation with them. And then you find out that his name is Muhammad or something along those lines. Oh, subhanAllah, you're a Muslim, you know. Although this should not be the case, the Muslim should be, if not through his appearance, through his statements. Alhamdulillah, subhanAllah, insha'Allah. You know, the remembrance of Allah is always on the tongue. Well, it doesn't take you 5-10 minutes to realize that this person you're speaking to is actually a believer. So this is just an example. Now, we mentioned last week that there were two conditions for the deed to be accepted by Allah. Who could remind me of the two conditions? Ikhlas and the niyyah is ikhlas. The niyyah to be sincere to Allah and follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now I need the evidence. The evidence. You must have a dalil. Nothing in Islam comes like that.
To believe the unseen.
No. Okay. That's correct. But we said that your deed, when you do an act of worship, for Allah to accept it, you need two things. First, you should do it for the sake of Allah, not for the creation. Second, you should follow the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, for these two conditions, Habibi, there are evidences from the Quran and the Sunnah. Otherwise, I could not tell you that this is a condition unless I have an evidence that it is a condition. So can anyone quote to us the actual evidence, the dalil? Very important. That's why I suggested that they take a note so you can write down the dalil. So next time you are in this predicament, you'll be able to give it to me ala tol. Huh? The dalil for ikhlas. It's an ayah in the Quran. Surah Al-Kahf. The last verse. Remember the last verse. Just remember this one. Surah Al-Kahf, you read it every Friday. It's a sunnah to recite it every Friday. The last verse. فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. So whosoever looks forward to meeting his Lord, let him do a righteous deed and associate none in worship with his Lord. إخلاص. Do a deed, do it only for Allah, and don't ascribe any partners with Allah. That's the dalil for sincerity. We should memorize this. If you ever want to give da'wah, if you ever want to be involved in inviting non-Muslims to Islam, or even your family members who are not practicing, you must have some evidences. Otherwise, if you don't have an evidence, then someone else will come with the same methodology and tell you you have to do something, anything that he may create from his mind. And so if he doesn't provide you with an evidence, and you don't provide him with an evidence, you're the same. You can tell him, no, this is not from the Sunnah. Huh? You tell him, this is not from the Sunnah. You say, how do you know? You say, give me an evidence. He says, I don't have one. Then you tell him that you shouldn't do this. He says, give me an evidence. You say, I don't have one. So now you're the same. Although this should not be the case, you should have the upper hand. So evidences is crucial. Crucial in Islam, if you are in interested in making da'wah. So the evidence for ikhlas is the last ayah in Surah Al-Kahf. This is one of many. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. They were only commanded to worship Allah sincere to Him in the religion. This is in Surah Al-Bayyinah. And this is in Surah Al-Zumar in many, many different places. That the fact we were commanded to be sincere to Allah and worship. طيب. The second condition is following the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the action that you do should be according to the Sunnah. Otherwise, it will not be accepted. Does anyone remember the evidence for that one? It's a hadith. The hadith is Sahih Bukhari. The hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha. Okay, remember this one now. Bukhari, Aisha. She said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. وفي رواية in another narration, من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. Two different narratives, two different wordings of the hadith. The first one says, whomever innovates into this affair of ours, the affair of the deen, something that is not part of it will have it rejected. Anyone who brings a new act of worship, new ibadah, say you should do this, or you should do that, that is not in accordance with the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then he will have it rejected. Meaning Allah will not accept it. And rejection is the opposite of acceptance. And the other narration says, whomever does an action, one says whomever introduces for the innovator. The other one is for the follower, the one who follows the innovation. Whomever does an action that is not in accordance with this affair of ours will also have it rejected. So this hadith is an evidence, a dalil, for the statement that your act of worship will only be accepted by Allah if A, it is for the sake of Allah alone, B, it is according to the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Otherwise, we gave the example of someone who says, I want to pray Fajr 6 rak'at. Say, 2 is not enough. Allah deserves more. I want to pray Fajr 6 rak'at. What do we say to this brother? Say, Ya Akhi, you may be doing it for the sake of Allah, but this is an innovation into the deen of Allah, not according to the will of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inshallah, you pray 6 rak'at from now until you die. Allah will not accept not even one salah, because you're not coming with the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Either you know better than him, you cannot be a Muslim if you think you are more knowledgeable than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Or you're claiming that he cheated the ummah by not telling you that 6 is better than 2. He left you with incorrect information, so you were able to come up with it on your own. So you have no exit, really, except accusing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of the worst things. This is how the innovation come into the deen. You know, that's why Imam Malik rahimahullah said, من ابتدع في الإسلام بدعة ورآها حسنة فقد زعم أن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم خان الرسالة. لأن الله يقول اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم فما لم يكن دينا يومئذ لا يكون اليوم دينا. أو كما قال رضي الله عنه. He said, Imam Malik, one of the four ilma, who have a madhab, not that we follow him, we're just following his statement. We follow anyone who has the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, whomever introduces into Islam an innovation, and he sees it good, because you will never find an innovator who sees that his action is bad, otherwise he would leave it alone. He sees it as something good. He said, Imam Malik, this person has claimed that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ has betrayed the message of Islam. Because Allah says in the Quran, today I have perfected your religion for you. On that day, Islam was perfect. So Imam Malik said, whatever was not part of the deen then, could not become part of the deen today. When Allah made this statement, today the deen was perfect. What does perfect mean? Yeah, right where you need it to be. Huh? When you try a new thought and it's just perfect, it's perfect. You don't make it longer, you don't make it shorter, you don't make it wider, you don't touch it anymore because it is perfect. If you were to add something, it'll become imperfect. So when Allah says the day was, the religion was perfected, that concludes the story. You can never bring something new and think that you will get closer to Allah. Huh? If the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ did not teach us that particular thing 1400 years ago. طيب بارك الله فيكم. The Shaykh the Tirmidhi says, excuse me. ومن ثمرات الشهادة العظيمة تحرير القلب والنفس من الرق للمخلوقين والاتباع لغير المرسلين. What are the benefits? What are the fruits that we gain from the Shahada? The Shaykh said, رحمه الله, to free the heart from servitude to the creation. Freeing your heart from being a servant to the creation, whether it is the boss or someone in authority or something along these lines, where people take him as they obey them, as opposed to obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, when these people are asking for the disobedience of Allah, so you become a servant to the creation. The shahada takes you out from the servitude of the creation. And for the non-Muslims, those who worship cows and monkeys and idols and Jesus and the angels and anything else that they find, this is all the creation of Allah. So the shahada will take you from that servitude to the creation into the servitude of the Creator. And that's the best thing that can happen in someone's life. Furthermore, it will make you, وَالْإِتِّبَاعُ لِغَيْرِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. It will also free you from following other than the messengers. It will free you from following other than the messengers. And you have no choice. Either you follow the messengers or their enemies. Either the messengers or those who oppose them. So when you follow the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, you have automatically followed Nuh, Ibrahim, Musa, all the prophets who came before, those who were enumerated in the Quran and those who were not. You are an automatic follower of all of them because of the universality of their message. And this is the best way of life. For you to imitate a messenger of Allah, whom Allah chose and gave revelation to, is far better than imitating someone who's an enemy of Allah. Like many of these artists of nowadays and these players, you know, different sports, games, you have, you know, these famous individuals, famous singers, famous actors, that maybe some of the Muslims or some of the children of the Muslims take these people as examples to be followed. If they change their hairstyle, some of the Muslims will change their hairstyle. If he changes dress code, they will change their dress code. If he makes a new song, they will memorize it. Subhanallah. That's following a path other than that of the messengers. And this is definitely not going to take someone to Jannah unless they make a detour and go back on the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Secondly, after the shahadatayn, or the shahadatayn, the testimony, the two testimonies, the faith, we said they are all one, integrated into one, because of the relevance. The second thing that we do as Muslims is what? Establishing the salah. Iqamu salah. The Shaykh said, وَأَمَّا إِقَامُ الصَّلَاةِ فَهُوَ التَّعَبُّدُ لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى بِفِعْلِهَا عَلَى وَجْهِ الْإِسْتِقَامَةِ وَالْتَمَامِ فِي أَوْقَاتِهَا وَهَيْئَاتِهَا. It is devotion in worshipping Allah, devotion in the worship of Allah, by fulfilling all of the rites of the salah, all of the different etiquettes and the outer appearance of the salah and the inner one, while being conscious of its prescribed times. Yani you do the salah on time, not as some individuals do, who, you know, if they're working, so they continue to work, and then when they go home, they pray Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. Huh? All together. Jama'a, Ma'a, Qasr, Ma'a.
you name it. And quick like a chicken, you know, pecking food from the ground. And then they just, you know, go back to watching the television because there's a very important show that's about to come. And the salah is going to distract me from the show. So I really cannot afford to take, you know, more than 10 minutes in my, how many rak'ahs that would be? 4 for dhuhr, 4 for asr, that's 8. 4 for isha, that's 12, 15. Huh? Too long. We say to this individual, what made you reach the point where you pray 15 rak'ahs at the same time anyways? And Allah says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. Barely the salah was upon the believers during a prescribed time. You have a limitation. Once the time goes out, the salah time is out. Unless you have an excuse. And these excuses are very limited. Either you fell asleep, you didn't set the alarm, for whatever reason you didn't hear the alarm, you were extremely tired, so you fell asleep out of weakness, not intentionally. As some people go to, you know, before the salah, he goes to sleep. That's not acceptable. So that the urgent circumstances, you can count them on the fingers, very limited, for someone to be allowed to miss the salah or let the time go out. Some people be going on a trip, say, Malik, because we're going on a trip, even if they're not traveling, we will pray back then. You know, and then they wind up joining the salah or you know, doing something that may not be acceptable Islamically. So we should give this 5 to 10 minutes. We don't even want to say 5 minutes because the 5 minute salah is not really a salah. And if you really, 5 minutes should be 2 rak'ahs. The 2 rak'ahs that you pray, my brothers, should be 2 minutes, should be 5 minutes. And this is what is expected in terms of fulfilling the salah, iqamat al-salah. Because Allah does not say sallu, pray, establish the salah, which is stronger in meaning. Now, there are many narrations about the person who does the salah quickly. And I personally, excuse me for saying I personally like to call it, the police are chasing me salah. You know about that salah? The police are chasing me salah. Where a brother will come into the masjid, at adhan time, got nothing to do. And you know, he says, Allahu Akbar. And you may say Allahu Akbar at the same time with him. Let's say you begin the salah at the same time. So you're still doing dua al-istiftah. Subhanak Allahum bihamdik wa tabarak ismuk. Awil akhiri different adaya. Allahumma ba'ad bayna bana khataya. One of the adaya of istiftah. You didn't even finish it. The brother's already, Allahu Akbar. He's in ruku'. MashaAllah. When did you recite the Fatiha, ya Shaykh? Let's assume you don't know the dua al-istiftah. The one opening of the salah. The dua that Rasulullah used to do in the opening of salah. Abu Huraira said, O Messenger of Allah, I ask you by Allah, what is the silence that you have between Takbirat al-Ihram and the Fatiha? He said, he taught him the dua he used to say between Takbirat al-Ihram and the Fatiha. There are more than one supplication that you say between the Takbirat al-Ihram and the Fatiha. Let's say it's a sunnah. If you don't do it, it doesn't affect your salah. What about the Fatiha? Where are we from the Fatiha? And from the Hadith, the Qudsi, in Sahih Muslim, that Allah says about the Fatiha, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نَصْفَيْنِ وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ. I have divided the salah between myself and my servant into two parts. And my servant shall have that which he's asking for. إِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ أَلْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى حَمِدَنِي عَبْدِي. If the slave says, Alhamdulillah, all praises due to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, Allah will reply to you. And Allah will say, my servant has praised me. When you say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah will reply to you. When you say Malik Yawm al-Din, Allah will reply to you until the end of the Fatiha. After each one of the verses, you get a response from Allah. Subhanallah. Do we ever think about that in the salah? Only Allah knows. This is why Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah and many others say, it is not befitting for a believer to join the verses in the Fatiha. It is not befitting to say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Malik, Yawm al-Din, Iyyaka na'budu wa Iyyaka nasta'een. It's not befitting. Because Allah will be replying to you between the verses and you left no room for anything. And you're making the Fatiha more like a burden on your back that you need to just finish it already. And this is not what the salah is for. You're coming to worship Allah, not prison. You're not in prison. And somebody has a gun to your head and shackles around your arms talking about do some labor work. Where you come with your heart heavy and you feel like you struggle against, you know, the everything in the world. The salah is supposed to be the, as the Prophet ﷺ said, Arihna ya Bilal. Make us comfortable. Give us comfort, O Bilal, with the salah. وجعلت الصلاة قرة عيني. The salah was made the beauty of my eye. The Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, whenever something would trouble him, he would run to the salah. Nowadays we run from the salah. And then we wonder why the Muslims are in this condition. It's because we are in this condition. And until we change, it's not going to change. Until, even when we make dua, our hearts are absent. Even in dua al-qunut with the imam, only Allah knows what some of us are thinking. We may not even be absent-minded about what the dua is about. Of course, this is relevant to understanding it. But it doesn't require that you understand what is being said for you to feel that you are asking Allah, you're begging Allah. That's all you need, the feeling of begging Allah in the salah. So my brothers, the salah is very vital. So the police are chasing the salah. So before you finish the istiftah, dua al-istiftah, the brother is already in ruku'. Before he says Subhana Rabbi al-Azim once, he's already standing. Before he finished standing, before his back is straight, he dives for sujood like a swimming pool. Malish, you've seen it, you know what I'm saying. And it's all like this. It is as if he ran from the police and they're about to arrest him and take him to prison for life. He said, let me pray 2 rak'ah before the police come. Yalla ala tul bisura. Tick, tick, tick before the police come. Although you have 20 minutes for the iqamah and nothing else to do. You have nothing else to do. You want to recite the Quran? Do the salah first. The salah is more important. Because if you recite the Quran and it's not making your salah proper, then your recitation of the salah is not beneficial. Take your time. We need to learn how to be patient. Say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Your voice may be better than mine. Don't imitate my recitation. Pause. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Pause. Maliki Yawm al-Din. Learn what Allah is responding to you. There's a hadith. It's available in English, in Urdu, in Hindi, any language you speak. You will find it in Sahih Muslim. Learn what Allah responds to you. Then when you go for ruku', Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. Glory be to Allah, the Great. You realize that you're worshipping Allah, that this ruku' is an act of worship to Allah, that Allah sees you, Allah hears you. You are glorifying Allah. High above is Allah, any imperfection. That's what tasbih means. When you get up, سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَ, Allah hears the one who praises Him. Meaning Allah will respond to your supplication. رَبَّنَا لَكَ الْحَمْدِ. Take your time. Because when the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, during his time, a man came into the masjid and did the police of chasing me salah. When he finished, he went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and said, السلام عليكم. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, وَعَلَيْكُمُ السَّلَامِ ارجع فصلي فَإِنَّكَ لَمْ تُصَلِّي. He said, go back and pray. You did not pray. Subhanallah. This man, during his time, عليه السلام, went back and did the salah again. Came back to the Prophet ﷺ a second time. He said, As-salamu alaykum. He said, wa alaykum as-salam. Irji' fa-salli fa-innaka lam tu-salli. Go back and pray because you did not pray. Now, the man had obedience to the Prophet ﷺ. He would have said, they negotiate with him. Say, what do you mean I didn't pray? Didn't you see me pray right now? They didn't have that, this etiquette, as one of us may say. He would listen, obey, subhanAllah. Just look at this adab, this obedience. He told them, you didn't pray? Said, okay. He went and prayed again. Third time. Came back third time to the Prophet ﷺ. Said, As-salamu alaykum. Said, wa alaykum as-salam. Irja fa-salli fa-innaka lam tu-salli. Three times. Go back and pray, you didn't pray. Then the man realized that there's something wrong with the salah. He said, O Messenger of Allah, I don't know any better. Teach me. I don't know any better. Teach me. Now notice now, what did the Prophet ﷺ teach him? He taught him everything that me and you know in the salah, except that he continued to add one aspect. He said, حَتَّى تَطْمَئِنْ فَسْجُدْ حَتَّى تَطْمَئِنَّ سَاجِدًا فَرَكَ حَتَّى تَطْمَئِنَّ رَاقِعًا. Prostrate until you reach tranquility in your prostration. Bow until you reach tranquility, comfort, relaxation, peace in your ruku'. And he continued to repeat that throughout the salah. So he made that element, that's why the scholars say, tumu'nina, tranquility is a pillar of the salah. If you don't have it in the salah will not be accepted. You must take your time. You must take your time, take it easy. No one is rushing. No one is rushing you. And the Prophet ﷺ said, a man will come into salah and he will leave and he will only get 1/10 of it. 1/9, 1/8, 1/7. You may leave the salah with no reward. So this is a very serious affair. In another occasion, he sees someone praying this quick salah. He says, if this man dies like this, he has died upon a religion other than that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The affair is serious, ya akhwan. But this is a very common problem among the Muslims today. So myself and you should be among those who change this way. The Salaf, the righteous predecessors, used to warn. They said, they will come a day where you enter the masjid and you will not find a single person in khushu'. A day will come on the Muslim ummah where you will not find a single person feeling submissiveness in his salah. Everybody's just doing harakat. This is not even speaking about those who look around in the salah. This is another calamity. Because the Prophet ﷺ used to look at the place of sujood. He would look where he's going to put his head the whole time. Now, when you're done with the salah and you're leaving, huh? You see brothers looking at you. Yes, sir. Keith, how? Are you praying to Allah? Are you saying something in the Fatiha? How are you looking at me? Looking around, people coming. How are you going to be able to focus on your salah when you see human beings moving around you? Obviously, this negates khushu'. We are supposed to look at the place of sujood. Don't be looking at no one. Even if someone walks in front of you, don't look at him. It may distract you from the salah. So these are things that are absent. Perhaps we will revive them into our lives. Bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is as far as the salah is concerned. وَمِنْ ثَمَرَاتِهِ إِنْشِرَاحَ الصَّدْرِ وَقُرَّةِ الْعَيْنِ وَالْإِنْزِجَارِ عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. From the benefits that we need, excuse me, from the salah, is the openness of the chest. And what is intended by that is not in the physical sense, where your chest will become white if you're doing a lot of bodybuilding. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the fact that your chest will be open for obedience. Anything that comes from Allah and His Messenger, you'll be happy to implement. Because some people don't have that. Allah says in the Quran, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Look at these verses in the Quran, maybe you've never heard them before in your life. Allah swears in the Quran, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ Nay by your Lord, the Lord of whom Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Allah swears by Himself, they shall not believe until they make you a judge first regarding everything that they dispute about. The first level is that you refer to the Sunnah. What did the Prophet ﷺ say regarding that? If you don't find it in the Quran, ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَدَيْتَ. Then they do not find within themselves any discomfort with your ruling. When you tell someone, ya akhi, the Prophet ﷺ said that you should drink while sitting down. You should eat while sitting down. If something in your chest strikes you as displeasing or discomfort, Allah says that you have not really believed. You're a believer. Don't understand me. They're not saying this person is a kafir. But his iman is not sound. Because Allah says that you should not find in your chest any discomfort. When it comes to you from the sunnah that you are supposed to do A or B or C, then the ultimate iman is that you don't have any discomfort in your heart. This is the second level. Then the end of the verse says, وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Redundant, repetitive. And they submit in full submission. So first you return it to the sunnah, then you do not have any discomfort in your heart, then you submit in total submission. What did you say? بِإِذْنَا I will do it from tomorrow. You see a brother walking around with his pants hanging way below his ankles. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, on the authority of Abu Hurairah, مَا أَسْفَلَ مِنَ الْكَعْبَيْنِ مِنَ الْإِزَارِ فَفِي النَّارِ. Whatever is below the garment, whatever from your lower garment that goes below the ankles will be in the fire. This is other than the hadith about the one who does it with arrogance. Because some people say, I'm not doing it out of arrogance. This is for another group of people who are doing it out of arrogance. This hadith deals with anyone whose garment is below his ankles. He falls under this danger zone. So, let's assume, ya akhi, it's a sunnah. Let's say it's not a wajib. There's a difference of opinion among the scholars, and you like to take it easy. Tayyib, although this is not the case, but I don't want to impose anything on anyone. We'll leave the room open until the brothers willingly follow the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad. What we are supposed to do, my brothers, in reality, is not negotiate whether this is a wajib or a mustahab or a sunnah or an obligation. This should not be the slogan of the Muslim. You should not go into that. Our goal should be, is that what the Prophet ﷺ did? Then I will do it bi-idhnillah from now. Then you leave the masjid, you go to the tailor. Here's 5 riyals, see these pants, make them above the ankles, Anbi. The boss doesn't like it, he doesn't have to like it. He will not judge you on the day of judgment. The people may laugh, who cares what the people laugh? Allah told us that they will laugh on the believers in this dunya, but on the day of judgment the believers will laugh at them. So we should not really gamble with our deen. Once you know a sunnah, whether it is obligatory or just recommended, we should hasten to follow the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So someone who does this, first he refers to the sunnah, then his heart is not discomfort, does not have any discomfort with the ruling, huh? Then he submits in total submission, then this is the one who the verse does not, is not implemented on him. Then this person's iman is sound. Because Allah began, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Nay, by your Lord, they will not believe until, and Allah enumerated the 3 levels. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who implement them in their lives. So your chest will be open, my brothers and sisters in Islam. قُرَّةِ الْعَيْنِ, the pleasure of the eye. The salah will make you happy, but this will only be the case when you do it properly. And it takes some time. Don't expect the next time you do salah for you to suddenly to do a long salah and to feel happy in it. Because we have too many whispers from the shaitan, too many sins, which may become a barrier between us and reaches this level. But if you continue to strive, then you will reach a day, bi-idhnillah, that where the salah will become the comfort of your eye. You will never really be happy until you're in the masjid doing the salah. And this is a level that may be attained after some effort. It does not happen while we are sleeping. And lastly, salah will prevent you, will be a source of refrainment from evil sins, whether major sins or minor sins. When you do the salah, you will have less sins committed, bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was the second. Thirdly, ita'u zakat, paying zakat, the compulsory charity. It is, as a definition, فَهُوَ التَّعَبُّدِ لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى بِبَذْلِ الْقَدْرِ الْوَاجِبِ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ الزَّكَوِيَّ الْمُسْتَحَقَّةِ. It is means of worshipping Allah by by paying a required compulsory amount from wealth that has reached the point of zakat, that has reached the point of nisab, which is when the amount becomes in a certain level, whether it is gold or silver or money, it depends. I'm not going to go into the details. Once a whole year has passed, and this is money that you're saving, then you pay 2.5% of his money and what have you. This is what zakat is given to the poor and the needy and those who are struggling in the cause of Allah and the ones who were enumerated in the Quran. The eight categories of those who are eligible for the zakat. You should not give it to anyone else. وَمِنْ ثَمَرَاتِهِ تَطْهِيرُ النَّفْسِ مِنَ الْقُلُقِ الرَّذِيلِ الْبُخُلِ وَسَدُّ حَاجَةِ الْإِسْلَامِ وَالْمُسْلِمِينَ. What do you benefit from the zakat? You purify your soul, yourself, from evil character like being miserly, being stingy, not wanting to spend. Furthermore, it fulfilling the needs of Islam and the Muslims. By paying the zakat, the Muslims do not need to ask anything from any non-Muslim. Everything will come from within the Muslim community. أما صوم رمضان فهو تعبد لله تعالى بالإمساك عن المفطرات في نهر رمضان. As for the fasting of Ramadan, it is worshipping Allah by avoiding anything that is known to void your fasting. Anything which invalidates the fast, you leave that alone. Of course, without enumerating eating and drinking and having, you know, some relation with the spouse, and or, you know, inhaling something or taking something into the blood, some shots straight to the vitamin, a vitamin that is a nutritious vitamin, and the other things that the scholars have enumerated among the things that will invalidate one's fast. What do you benefit from fasting? تَرْوِيدُ النَّفْسِ عَنْ تَرْكِ الْمَحْبُوبَاتِ طَلَبًا لِمَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلِ. It is coaching. It means of coaching oneself or training oneself to leave alone things that are beloved. Seeking the pleasure of Allah. You love to eat. We love to drink. We love to do the things that Allah made halal for us. But during Ramadan, you leave these things that are beloved to you, seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the benefit of fasting. وأما حج البيت فهو التعبد لله تعالى بقصد البيت الحرام للقيام بشعائر الحج.
As for Hajj to the sacred house, it is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by visiting or going to the sacred house and establishing the rites of Hajj.
ومن ثمراته, from the benefits, ترويض النفس على بذل المجهود المالي والبدني بطاعة الله تعالى.
Training oneself to spend physically and financially in means of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
ولهذا كان الحج نوعا من جهاد في سبيل الله.
This is why Hajj was considered a form of jihad, because you are using your physical ability and your financial ability.
In the salah is strictly physical. Do you pay money when you do salah?
No. Zakah is strictly financial. Fasting is strictly physical.
Hajj is a combination of both.
Hajj is a combination of both, physical and financial.
طيب. I hope you remember these, inshallah.
طيب. The Shaykh said, وهذه الثمرات التي ذكرناها لهذه الأسس وما لم نذكره تجعل من الأمة أمة إسلامية طاهرة نقية.
He said, these aforementioned information, the things that we mentioned earlier and the things which we did not mention, make from this ummah a virtuous and pure Islamic nation.
تدين لله دين الحق, which adheres to Allah with the religion of truth.
وتعامل الخلق بالعدل والصدق,
and it treats the creation of Allah with justice and with truthfulness.
لأن ما سواها من شرائع الإسلام يصلح بصلاح هذه الأسس.
Everything else, all of the various branches of Islam, will only be rectified and sound if these foundations are sound.
If these five pillars are sound, then everything else that is required of us will also be sound.
Sound meaning good, in good condition, does not have any deficiency.
وتصلح أحوال الأمة بصلاح أمر دينها,
and the affair of this nation, the Muslims, will only be rectified when the affair of the deen will be rectified.
The Muslims will only be in good condition when their adherence to the deen of Islam will be also in good condition.
ويفوتها من صلاح أحوالها بقدر ما فاتها من صلاح أمور دينها.
And we will be losing and missing from the benefits and the victory and the honor of the Ummah as much as we miss from our adherence to Islam.
So they are, it's like domino effect. You know, they go hand in hand.
You establish and you adhere to the deen of Islam, then Allah will give us succession on earth and authority.
And the more we do not adhere to the deen of Islam, the more that others will be given succession on earth and authority, and we will be subdued by them.
All these are indications that we should refer back to the basics of Islam, learn them properly, implement them in our lives, and teach them to those who are around us.
Now, do you want an evidence for that?
Of course. Let us see what Allah says in the Quran.
The Shaykh said, وَمَنْ أَرَادَ اسْتِبَانَةَ ذَلِكَ فَلْيَقْرَأْ قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى.
Whomever wants to really see the manifestation of this understanding, let him recite the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-A'raf, verses 96 until 99.
Allah says, وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَى آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبُوا فَأَخَذْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ.
Had the people of the villages, the people of the towns, يعني the different nations that came before us, had they only believed in Allah and the six pillars of Iman and had taqwa, we would have opened up the blessings from the heavens and from the earth. يعني rain will fall down and the earth will produce vegetation and sustenance will come from them, blessings will come from everywhere. Had they what? Believed and had taqwa of Allah.
Allah says, but they belied. So then we took them with the punishment because of what they used to earn.
They belied, they were punished.
Allah says then, أَفَأَمِنَ أَهْلُ الْقُرَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتِيَهُمْ بَأْسُنَا بَيَاتًا وَهُمْ نَائِمُونَ.
Do the people of the villages feel safe and secure from our punishment, that it may come to them during the night while they are sleeping?
أَوْ أَمِنَ أَهْلُ الْقُرَىٰ أَوْ أَمِنَ أَهْلُ الْقُرَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتِيَهُمْ بَأْسُنَا ضُحًا وَهُمْ يَلْعَبُونَ.
Or do the people of the towns and the villages feel secure that our punishment will come to them during the forenoon, before dawn, while they are playing? أفأمنوا مكر الله؟ Do they feel secure from the plan of Allah? فلا يأمن مكر الله إلا القوم الخاسرون. None truly feel secure from the plan of Allah except the people who are losers. Only the losers will think that because Allah allows them to continue to be alive and sustains them, that Allah is pleased with them and that no punishment will come to them. Only the losers. But the believers don't have these qualities. We should all always be mindful. Perhaps the brothers and sisters, our sins that me and you commit are part of the reason why the Muslims all over the world are suffering. The sin that you do is not only a calamity upon you, it's a calamity upon your family and your society and the whole Muslim Ummah. The sins that we commit. Because of these verses we understand that when we lack iman and lack taqwa, then the punishment will encompass all. So we need to be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and strictly avoid sins as much as possible with our shortcoming. And when we do fall short because of our weakness, we should turn in repentance to Allah. We will disobey Allah. We're not angels. But we should turn in repentance to Allah, say, Astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayh. And we will deal one day, inshallah, with the conditions of tawbah. Because tawbah is not just saying, Astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayh. There are things that we are required to do for the tawbah to be accepted. Then the Shaykh said, وَلْيُنْظَرْ فِي تَارِيخِ مَنْ سَبَقْ فَإِنَّهُ فِي التَّارِيخِ عِبْرَةِ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Furthermore, look into the history of the previous nations. Verily in the facts that occurred to them, there's a reminder for people of understanding. Look at the nations that were destroyed. And look at their homes and the castles and the palaces that they left behind. And some other people came and inhabited them. What happened to the people of Lut? What happened to the people of Hud? What happened to the people who disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Musa, those who disobeyed Musa, Fir'aun, Allah drowned them. The people of Nuh, Allah drowned them. Allah punished the nations, the akhwan, who disobeyed Allah. So we need to be careful of that. وَبَصِيرًا لِمَنْ لَمْ يَحِلْدُونَ قَلْبَهُ حِجَابٍ. And it is means of insight for the one who does not have veils covering his heart. وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانِ. And Allah's aid is sought. Yani we do not seek assistance except from Allah. Maybe you hear this a lot. Some brothers ask me, what does Allah musta'an? You always say Allah musta'an. Isti'ana comes from the same word, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Isti'ana, seeking aid. So Allah musta'an, meaning Allah's aid is sought. Yani sought is the past of seek. You seek refuge in Allah. You sought refuge in Allah. So Allah's aid is sought, meaning Allah's aid is required, is asked for, is needed by us. This is what Allah musta'an means. أسس العقيدة الإسلامية. طيب, we said Islam had two things. Who remembers them? Not the conditions. We said Islam is made up of two things. No. Yes. Yes. But no. Yes, but not what I'm looking for. Because remember before we broke down the five pillars of Islam, we said that Islam is made of two things. Aqidah, creed, and legislation, shari'. Huh? Iman, things that pertain to the belief system, and law, do's and don'ts. Yani sharia is what? Do's and don'ts. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, do this. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, don't do this. Sharia is do's and don'ts. طيب, aqidah is belief. You don't do and you don't in a belief. You just believe. So Islam, as on more general basis, besides the Quran and the Sunnah, is divided into aqidah and law. We said aqidah means a creed and shari'ah means law. So the Shaykh went on to repeat, كما سبق عقيدة وشريعة. الدين الإسلامي, as we mentioned before, is عقيدة, creed, وشريعة, law. وقد أشرنا إلى شيء من شرائعه وذكرنا أركانه التي تعتبر أساسا لشرائعه. He said, and we mentioned some of the laws of Islam, and we mentioned some of their pillars, which are considered to be the foundation, such as the Salah and the Zakah, what we just mentioned. These are all from the laws. طيب, do's and don'ts. Establish the Salah, pay the Zakah, do Hajj, do Umrah, so forth. أما العقيدة الإسلامية, as for the Islamic creed, فأسسها, its foundation is الإيمان بالله, believing in Allah, وملائكته and Allah's angels وكتبه Allah's books ورسله Allah's messengers واليوم الآخر and the day of judgment والقدر خيره وشره and preordainment the good of it and the evil thereof the good and the evil we must know these six pillars of Iman five pillars of Islam six pillars of Iman believing in Allah His angels, His books, His messengers, the Day of Judgment, and preordainment. And you should memorize them in Arabic. And تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره. With repetition, it will be ingrained in your brain, inshallah. What is the evidence for that? وقد دل على هذه الأسس كتاب الله وسنة كتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. These six pillars of iman have been indicated by the Quran, the book of Allah, and the Sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. As for the Quran, ففي كتاب الله تعالى يقول الله. Allah says in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 177. ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب. عفوا ليس البر. ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب ولكن البر من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر والملائكة والكتاب والنبيين Allah says piety is not that you only turn your face towards المشرق الإيست أو المغرب or west this is not only piety this is similar to what I mentioned about the salah outwardly you're doing it but inwardly you're dead That's not piety. But verily piety, those who are pious, are those who believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment, the last day, and the angels, and the books, and the prophets. So five of them were mentioned in one ayah. Huh? What are we missing? Al-Qadr. So we go to Surah Al-Qamar for Qadr. Verse 49 and 50, Allah says, إِنَّا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَاهُ بِقَدَرٍ Verily everything we created is with decree. With the qadr. وَمَا أَمْرُنَا إِلَّا وَاحِدَةٌ كَلَمْحِ الْبَصَرِ And our command is nothing except like the twinkle of an eye. The command of Allah is just like a twinkle of an eye. كُن فَيَكُون Be and it is. There's no delay in the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the evidence for qadr. وَفِي سُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ From the sunnah of the Prophet صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ The hadith that we mentioned last time, يقول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام مجيبا لجبريل حين سأله عن الإيمان. The messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم told جبريل when he asked him about إيمان أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره which was just mentioned to believe in Allah and his angels and his books and his messenger and the day of judgment and the preordainment the good of it and the bad thereof. These are the six pillars of إيمان. بإذن الله عز وجل next week we will begin with the concept of إيمان in Allah what is إيمان in Allah there are four categories for our إيمان in Allah I will leave them as a surprise or maybe you'll get interested to know what they are and usually those who like to seek knowledge are always looking forward for more knowledge so perhaps you'll be thinking maybe think of your own What are the foundation of believing in Allah is based on four things. Try to think of your own what they may be. And maybe you could share it with us next week inshallah. This is as far as the book is concerned. We will conclude with this. I have an issue here. Many of you wrote your cell phone numbers and your email addresses in the first day. If you did not receive an email, until today, that means that I had a hard time reading your handwriting. Because I did suffer trying to see some of the things. So, if you have not received any emails from me, since you've given me your name, kindly write it again. Right now, in big, bold, capital letters. Even if you use three spaces. But I would like to have it so I could send you information, different beneficial information. If you have not signed up before, then kindly, if you wish, it's not an obligation, you can give me your name, you don't have to give me your name, at least your cell phone number and your email address. Why? There are many lectures being conducted in English, in different venues, a lot of events in English, Islamic. Anytime there's an event, I will send you an SMS to let you know, and an email, that's it. If you think that I'm going to violate your rights, don't give me any information. This is just strictly brotherly. Nothing is not going to, I'm not going to sell it to any company who will be giving them telemarketing or anything. So this is the paper over here. If this is your father, you better obey him. He's what? Okay. Even if okay, I'm not going to go into details. I need to have more information from you before I accuse you of anything. Tayyib, jazakallahu khair. So here it is. Just feel free to, if you've never received an email and he gave you email, write it again. If you've never filled it out before, hayakallah. Oh, one more reminder. We have another Aqeedah class in Hayy al-Mushrifa Da'wah Center on 70 between Maghrib and Isha. It is more sophisticated. This is basic. The other one is very advanced. So if you wish to take it easy, then this is good for now. If you want to go into the details of knowledge of Allah's names and attributes, then you are welcome to join us every Saturday after Maghrib in Hayy al-Mushrifa Da'wah Center on 70 Street over Tihama Bookstore. You can call me, I'll give you directions. Inshallah, you can ask me, I'll give you directions. That's one. And
Monday.
Every Monday there's an Arabic class at 6:30 at the same Da'wah Center in Hayy al-Mushrifa by Dr. Yahya al-Bahith, a very beloved brother of ours. And
after
Isha, he has a fiqh class. So on Monday, between Maghrib and Isha, Arabic class. After Isha, fifth class. Every Monday in Hayy al-Mushrifa Da'wah Center. Who doesn't speak Urdu here? You don't speak Urdu. Fine. The khutbah translation, because if you're not benefiting from Sheikh Yasir, since it's in Urdu, Masjid Umm al-Qura, the khutbah has been translated there to English. You know Masjid Umm al-Qura. So you may go over there from now on, or you can attend Hayy al-Mushrifa where the khutbah is in English. But I don't want to scare the people away from here. But there's a khutbah conducted in English at the Da'wah Center in Hayy al-Mushrifa. I'm just giving you options. You do whatever you think is best for you. Tayyib? Subhanakallah wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.